Good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship on this, the sixth Sunday of Easter. And as our call to worship, I'm going to read a few verses from Psalm 66, reading from verse 8. Bless our God, you nations. Let the sound of his praise be heard. He preserves us in life. He keeps our feet from stumbling. For you, God, have put us to the test and refined us like silver. You have brought us into the net. You have bound our bodies fast. You have let people ride over our heads. We went through fire and water, but you have brought us to a place of plenty.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we come before you this morning, distant in our locations, but close in fellowship and faith. We come seeking your presence in our lives and in our world. For you are the true and the living God. You are above all, beneath all, and besides all that we say and do in our world. You were there at the beginning of the world and have been active in the life of your people throughout history. You are a never-changing, all-powerful, all-loving God. In Jesus, your Son, we find life and life in all its fullness. So this morning, we come drawn by the power of your welcoming love, a love that simply will not let us go. We pray that you will allow us to worship you in spirit and in truth. Help us to support and encourage each other. Help us to love as we are loved. Spirit of truth, come and abide with us. Amen. A prayer of confession. God of love, we are sorry that at times our love for you falters, that we have wrong priorities, that we overlook your guidance. O God, forgive us. O God, unite us. Loving Saviour, we are sorry that we disobey your commandments, that we fail to love, that we walk by on the other side. O God, forgive us. O God, unite us. Spirit of truth, we are sorry that we disregard your presence, that our thoughts and feelings are unrighteous, that we follow the world's way. O God, forgive us. O God, unite us. May your presence abiding in us lead us in the right way. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Here is the good news. Those who confess their sins in the name of Jesus will be forgiven. Amen. Thanks be to God. We say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
John chapter 14, verses 15 to 21. Jesus said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Love all things around. love so precious and deep. He wants me to receive his love, to make my life complete. And goes. I often find it hard to love my neighbors and my foes. God wants me to take his love and plant it in my heart. So all I meet will come to see God's love fills every part.
I wonder if you've ever got yourself lost, really lost. Maybe trying to find a shop or a house in a part of town you don't know. Frantically following a map or a mobile phone app that gives you confusing advice. Knowing that as time passes, you're becoming later and later for your appointments. Happened to me as a young man living in Tokyo. It was shortly after my arrival. I was still jet-lagged. I hardly spoke a word of Japanese at that point. I didn't know the city at all. But in my youthful foolishness, I had decided to visit a large shopping district. On my way back, I just could not find myself home. I was completely lost, completely disorientated. It was quite a frightening experience. Maybe this is the way many of us are feeling at the moment, in the midst of this coronavirus epidemic. Lost and disorientated. We have completely lost the routine of our days, as our work is taken away from us, as we can't visit the places and be with the people that we would like to be with. All the days of the week seem to just merge into one. In fact, we're not aware what day of the week it is. Last week we started to look at words Jesus shared with his disciples at the Last Supper. Words taken from John's Gospel, chapter 14. These disciples were also feeling rather lost, rather anxious, rather disorientated. Jesus wants to offer them encouragement at this critical time. And so he told them that he was the way, the truth, and the life. This week we're going to move on a little in this chapter, and we're going to look at that great promise Jesus gives us at this difficult time. The promise that those who believe and trust in him will not be left alone, but that they will be given the gift of the Holy Spirit. Here are his words. If you love me, you will obey my commands, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another to be your advocate, who will be with you forever. So, critical to this promise is that the faith of the disciples must remain authentic and sincere. A faith which is authentic and sincere is one which is driven by love. Love for God, love for each other. A love made clear by the self-giving way in which the disciples lead their lives as they continue Jesus' ministry of bringing health and healing to the sick and the infirm, offering warmth and hospitality to the lost and the stranger, love and sustenance to the children, the elderly and the vulnerable of their worlds. This is an authentic faith which leads to authentic good deeds of mercy. To those that keep that authentic alive is promised the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit who will allow this deep and intimate relationship Jesus has with his disciples to thrive and to flourish once he has physically left this world. Jesus tells us in these verses quite a lot about this Holy Spirit. He says, for example, in verse 17, that the world cannot accept him because they neither see nor know him. So his presence in the world is kept hidden from those who are cynical or untrusting. Instead, he says of the disciples and the friends of Jesus today, "You know him because he dwells in you and will be in you." So, those who have found the risen Jesus in their lives open themselves up to a whole new outlook on life. They open themselves to the ongoing and rejuvenating presence of God's Holy Spirit. What will mark out this Spirit is that it will be a Spirit of truth. It will be a Spirit to offer us clear and reassuring guidance when times are difficult. Clear and reassuring truth when the way ahead seems unpassable. Clear and reassuring truth to navigate those obstacles that appear to block our path in life. Clear and reassuring words to go and make a success of our lives when we feel ourselves to be confused, oppressed, downtrodden, or low in morale. What good and what encouraging, life-giving words these are to us who struggle to make sense of life at this difficult time. Jesus does not mince his words at the Last Supper. He tells his friends that very soon they will not see him. Very soon, as I mentioned last week, he will be taken from them by force, and they will have to endure watching him suffer and die on a cross. But very soon after, he will be with them again. Why? Well, he goes on to say, "Though the world may no longer see me, you will. You will see me, because I live, you too will live." In other words, they will see and they will know the risen Jesus. These are words that predict those graveside appearances, the appearance on the road to Emmaus and the appearances in the upper room, which we looked at after Easter. And what is more, they who share the authentic faith in this risen Jesus know that life, not death, has the final word. They too look forward to the blessings of life after death, of life eternal in God's kingdom. One of the most difficult things about lockdown is that we haven't been able to see people who live outside our homes, whom we love so dearly. So grandparents haven't been able to see grandchildren, and grown-up brothers and sisters have been kept apart. I know that things have become a little bit more relaxed this week. I know also that social media and things like Zoom and Skype have allowed us to keep in touch. But it's not quite the same, is it? It's not the same as being able to enjoy those warm, loving embraces, to be able to sit at table, to laugh, to look people in the eye and to tell them how much we have missed them. Perhaps that's what the disciples feared as well. Jesus would no longer be there. So how could they possibly go on doing the things that they had done before? In these verses, Jesus tells his friends that he may no longer be their visible teacher and guide, but through his Holy Spirit, he will still be with them. He will help them to go about their lives and to continue the mission that he had started, and they'll do so with confidence and in safety. This Holy Spirit will also be their advocate, that is, one who will take their side in an argument, one who will fight their case in whatever battle they find themselves in, and what battles they will soon find themselves in, and how much they will rely on that trusty advocate to see them survive some painful scrapes. This Holy Spirit is also a helper in time of need. This Holy Spirit is one who will always be there to comfort in times of grief and to encourage in time of doubt and fear. My friends, these are no doubt times of fear, of grief and anxiety in which we live. How much do we need this Holy Spirit in our lives? How much do we need the one who fights our corner, the one who offers us words of truth, the one who is a trusty helper when we feel alone? The promise of this Holy Spirit is a promise for each and every one of us today. Here is a God who comes to us daily. Here is a God we can turn to when all else seems dark and hopeless. Here is a God who will renew us with his Spirit. Here is a God who will equip us with his truth and will send us out into the world with joy and with confidence to continue his ministry and to embrace the gift of life that is life in all its fullness this day and forevermore. Amen.
Let us join together in prayer. Lord of all, we pray for those who in different ways are spending much of their lives in the service of others, those whose work offers us the care, the security, and the support that we have taken for granted. In all their work, Lord, uphold them. We think of those in hospitals or hospices, in the police, the armed forces, or the emergency services. in voluntary services and charities, in social and community work, in schools, colleges, and universities, in the church or the mission field, in local, national, and international government. In all their work, Lord, uphold them. Loving God, we thank you for all those who provide service in so many different ways. Strengthen and encourage them in their work. Give them the support, inspiration, and resources they need, and work through them to express your love for the world. In all their work, Lord, uphold them, for we ask it in the name of Christ. Amen. Loving God, we pray for those who face the future with uncertainty or anxiety, those who fear it, who despair of it, or who feel they have no future. We pray for those who face trauma and upheaval in their lives. What seems secure swept from under them. What they had hoped for denied them. We pray for those who doubt their ability to cope with what life may bring. Those overwhelmed by pressures, paralyzed by fears, crushed by sorrows. Living God, reach out to all for whom the future seems uncertain or unwelcome, and bring the assurance that even in the darkest moments, the greatest challenges, the most worrying times, you are there, and you are able to bring light out of darkness, hope out of despair, joy out of sorrow, and good out of evil. Father, grant us all the confidence that there is nothing in heaven or earth, in life or death, in the present or the future, that is able to separate us from your love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Well, I hope you found today's worship helpful and joyful and uplifting. Before the blessing, I just would like to encourage you all to also view our midweek Bible studies on the letter of James that my colleagues Abbe and Rohama have been leading. They're wonderful studies. They can be found on this same YouTube channel or else through the links that our circuit administrator has been sending us. And now may the good Lord bless us and keep us. May he make his face to rest and to shine upon us and give us his peace. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.
And sing your praises to the King. Lift your voice and let your hallelujahs ring. Come before his throne to worship and adore. Enter joyfully now the presence of the Lord. You're my Creator, you're my Deliverer, you're my Redeemer, you are Lord and you are my Healer. You're my provider, you're my shepherd and my guide, Jesus Lord and King of worship. Shout for joy and sing your praises to the King. Lift your voice and let your hallelujahs ring. Come before his throne to worship and adore. Now the presence of the Lord. You're my Creator, you're my Deliverer, you're my Redeemer, you are Lord and you are my Healer. You're my Provider, you are now my Shepherd and my God, Jesus, Lord and King, I worship you.